Starting at verse 1. I'm going to read about 4 verses. If you haven't said amen.
Amen.
If you don't have it, say wait a minute. Hebrews chapter 12, starting at verse 1. And it reads thusly, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We know the grass withers and the flower fades, but we know your word is going to stand there.
Yes.
And so, Father, I pray that you will anoint me for the proclamation of this word, but I pray that you anoint the hearers, Lord, that they will be focused on hearing what you would say to them through your word. Speak to our hearts this now. Allow us to be in your presence, and we thank you in advance for what you're going to do, which in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. From that text of scripture that I read, I do want to tag the text with this topic, Hidden Figures. And it primarily comes, well, that movie gives rise to the sermon, but primarily from the verse 1 and part A of that verse is, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Just talking about those who've gone wrong. We're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. He said, let us run this race. Let us run this race. Are you in the race today?
Amen.
Are you running? If you are not in the race, you need to get in the race.
Amen.
All right.
If you're in the race, you need to stay in the race.
That's right.
And be more determined to make it on to the finish line.
Amen.
Amen. But it was keep in context what today is all about, what this month is all about. It was February 20th, 1962, that John Glenn set atop a 95-foot intercontinental ballistic missile.
Wow.
It was at Cape Canaveral, 95 feet high, and after many delays to the countdown to take off, finally, it was Scott Carpenter. Anybody remember that name?
Yeah.
Scott Carpenter finally said to John, Godspeed. And you know what happened to the missile at that point. A lot of fire and dust and smoke. And he took off. He took off from Cape Canaveral, reaching speeds above 17,000 velocity. It it was moving, y'all. Over 17,000 miles per hour, Ovid orbited the Earth three times and then splashed down in Bermuda, about 880 miles, it said, from Bermuda. That's where it landed. And that, at that time, it is still today, great news. Amen. Great news. It was a big story. But whenever there's a big story, there are always little stories behind the big story.
Yeah.
A lot of times it's the little stories that make the big story happen. And so that day, it was John Glenn taking off, going into space, that was the big story. The first American to orbit the Earth. But the challenge to take off and to go up in the space, y'all stay with me, I'm on my way somewhere.
Okay, okay.
The challenge to take off, to leave the Earth, wasn't near as great as the one that would bring him back to the Earth.
Well, right.
And so, to get back into Earth's atmosphere, there had to be some very precision, very calculated math that had to be done.
Yes.
A lot of bright minds, intelligent people had to be used. But there was one person that John Glenn had told them, unless she was involved in the plan and the process to get that spacecraft back to Earth, he wasn't going up. He wasn't going up. NASA had just bought their first computer. But John would not trust the computers nor any other person to calculate his coming back into Earth's atmosphere. There was a young lady by the name of Catherine Johnson, Coleman, I think was her name. Catherine Johnson. She was a mathematician.
Yes.
And that's why I'm seeing the movie would make a difference right there.
Right.
She was extraordinary.
Yes, she was.
Mathematician. She was a black woman, y'all.
Yeah.
Amen.
She was a black woman. John said, I'm not taking off unless Catherine is involved in the process of my coming back in Earth's atmosphere. See, when that spacecraft had finished orbiting the Earth, and it orbited the Earth three times, he had only one opportunity to burst through the Earth's atmosphere, whatever that stuff is, and come through safely.
Yeah.
He wouldn't get another chance to go up and orbit and come back again. This would be the only opportunity that he had. And he knew how important that was, and he knew Catherine was one of the brightest minds of that day and time.
Amen.
But not only did Catherine have to deal with and compete with a lot of other intellectual minds, Catherine had to deal with two other things. And that was, she had to deal with racism and sexism. Racism in 1962 in the South, that was still colored restrooms and white restrooms. And some of y'all never had to experience that, and thank God that you did. Because God knows it was a challenge. Couldn't go into the rooms that said white. Only could go into ones that said color. She had to deal with that
even though she was the brightest mind in the room. But not only did she have to deal with racism, she had to deal with sexism. Because in 1992, it was 1962, thank you, it was still considered a white man's world. So we all don't believe that either. But it was so. It was so. And even though she had some challenges to deal with, Catherine Coleman, Goebel Johnson dealt with it and was used as the chief person to calculate the return of John Glenn to the earth. And he did return success. Oh, that day John Glenn became an instant hero. But that was some hidden figures. There were some hidden figures behind the scenes that made it possible for John Glenn to take the orbit and the trip that he took. Everybody in here today has some hidden figures in our lives. Everybody. There's somebody who has an impact on our lives that in many instances, nobody knows about but you and those persons. Yeah. Some we'll never know about until we get to heaven.
Yeah. All right, man.
Amen. Nobody that's successful in life made it by themselves. There's somebody else involved in their life.
Amen.
Some Sunday school teacher. Some grandparent. Some parent, some principal of a school, somebody made a difference and invested in our lives. I remember my Sunday school superintendent, little frail lady. I remember her like it was yesterday. Some of you won't be able to identify with this, but she made sure every Sunday that the church was open and there was heat in the church. Now, getting the heat in the church wasn't an easy thing back then. It wasn't as simple as going to the wall and turning the thermostat on. But she was a dedicated Sunday school person. And I think that has something to do even today why I love Sunday school so much. Somebody was involved in our lives. Some hidden figure. That made a difference in our lives. Catherine Johnson was recognized by President Obama. She was 97 years old now. And some of us would probably never known about her if President Obama hadn't recognized her. We would have never known. We would have never known about this great woman who was involved in the first orbit around the world in our space program. And if it had not been for Catherine Coleman Johnson, Russia probably would have been the one who won the space program. They would have been the first one to have gotten up there. But we got to the moon the other day. How many of y'all maybe went to the moon? Some people don't believe that. But we were the first to get to the moon because of Catherine Coleman. But she was a hidden figure, y'all. Nobody knew about her, and there are still those today that don't know about her. But she made a difference. She made a difference. If it had not been for Is there never been an Aaron that may have not been a Moses?
Amen.
Break it down.
Has there never been a Naomi that may not be a Ruth? If it had not been for Andrew, may not have been Peter. Ain't that wrong with me? He sees that impacts our lives. Well, I'm going to the text. But the text talks about a great cloud of witnesses.
That's right.
Those that have come through here, walk the walk, made it successful, and are now in heaven looking down on us.
Yes, right.
Hidden figures. Those witnesses are insurance to us that if we stay faithful, we too will be in that number. When the saints go marching, hidden figures, hidden figures. Catherine Coleman Johnson, a hidden figure. But here's another figure that I want to talk about that's not so hidden. The Bible tells us to set our eyes on Jesus. Who is the author and the finisher of our faith. And so the first thing is the challenge of our faith. And the second thing is the challenge to stay focused. Jesus will only help us as much as we can focus on him. I wish I had some. Peter said, Lord, bid me come to you. Jesus said, come on, Peter. He got out of the boat and started to walk on water. And I just, in my own sanctified imagination, like to think what happened to Peter when he actually realized that he was walking on water. That God Almighty.
Yes, Lord.
I believe he got some pep in his step. But he took his eyes off of Jesus. And when he took his eyes off of Jesus, that was when he began to sink. Listen, brothers and sisters, we've got to keep our eyes on the Lord. We keep our eyes on the Lord. The Lord will take care of the rest. That's the challenge. Keep your eyes. I woke up this morning with my mind,
set on Jesus.
Paid on the Lord. Keep your mind on him. When you get up to go to work, keep your mind on him. While you're on your job, keep your mind on him. When you get off and on your way home, talk to him a little bit then. Sit down to eat your evening meal. Talk to the Lord some more. Keep your mind. Stay on the Lord. The Bible said, Isaiah said in chapter 26, Isaiah said, he will keep you, he will keep us in perfect peace. If we keep our minds stayed on the Lord. I challenge you today to keep your mind, keep your thoughts, stay focused on Jesus. Don't keep it on me, I can't help you. Matter of fact, I've got to keep mine on Jesus. Enoch, in the 11th chapter of Hebrew, that was a great Hebrew chapter.
Amen.
But none of them fellows can help us. Enoch, Joshua, Elijah, and Daniel, all them folks that, you know, Spirit in your life. I don't care what area. He promised.
Thank you, Lord.
The author and the finisher. Amen. The beginning and the end.
Amen.
The Alpha.
Amen.
And the Omega.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's the center and he's the circumference.
Yeah.
He's all that.
Yeah.
When you got Jesus, you got everything you need.
Yeah.
Old folks, you say, I'm wrapped up, tied up, and tangled up in Jesus. Because they knew Jesus was the answer.
Yeah, right.
They didn't understand the answer, but they knew he was the answer.
Right.
And he's still the answer.
Yes, he is.
Yes, he is, yes, he is, brothers and sisters.
Yes.
Jesus is still the answer. And we need to stay in the race and keep our minds focused on Jesus while we are in the race.
Yeah,
am I right, somebody?
Yes.
Yeah, because Jesus is all that.
Yes.
He all that plus.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
We think about what the text says when the text talks about all these persons. No doubt there's any great cloud of witnesses.
Mm-hmm.
We think about those people and what they can do to help us and to encourage us along the way. Some people teach that verse as if to say they're looking down on us and encouraging us to go forward. But I say we ought to be looking at them and thinking about what they did and let that be an encouragement to us that if we walk as they walked and keep the faith as they kept the faith, then one day we'll be with Jesus in heaven.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
But we've got to walk by faith.
Yes.
Not by faith.
We've got to talk by faith.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Not committed to what we see, but committed to what we don't see.
Amen.
Am I right, somebody?
Amen.
Yeah, yeah. Keep him. See, Matthew 6:33 says, if you seek first
the kingdom of God.
Come on, y'all want to help me quote it? Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Huh?
All.
He says all.
Yeah.
All these things shall be added unto you. All these things shall be added unto you. But you gotta stay focused. You gotta stay faithful. Huh? You gotta stay focused and you gotta stay faithful.
Amen.
Yeah, this metaphor, cloud of witnesses, gives us the confidence and the assurance that we can make it.
Yeah.
And the writer says, let every one of us lay aside every weight.
Yeah.
Every weight. And that's talking about every hindrance.
That's right.
Let it aside. He said, let us run with patience.
Yes.
Run with patience.
Uh-huh.
The race that's set before us,
yes,
looking unto Jesus.
Amen. Thank you.
Hey, you got to stay focused.
That's right.
And you got to stay faithful.
Yes.
You got to keep your eyes on the star post in glory. It'll be the guiding light when we're going through our secret storm.
Yeah.
Help me, somebody.
All right.
Yes. Job was faithful.
Yeah.
And in the end, God added to him more than he had than in the beginning.
Yeah.
Brothers and sisters, there's nothing wrong with being a part of a fraternity. Nothing wrong with being part of a sorority.
Well,
nothing wrong with being part organize organizations to help in the community. But when these things get ahead and get in front of the Lord, they become weights that you need to lay aside. Sometimes weights can be in the form of people. People can be a hindrance to our running our race. And sometimes we need to let them go. I don't know whether you have ever thought about this or not, but the more God lifts you up, sometimes the less your circle has to become of people. You gotta let them go. I like Stephen Harvey, because Stephen Harvey always puts in perspective what it means to be a Christian and be a part of that. You know, actors in Hollywood and all that kind of stuff. Somebody asked Steve the question, are you going to allow your homies to come to where you are and share your property and your place of residence? Well, I'm not going to say it the way he said it. When he said, blankety blank, no. Well, why wouldn't you let your East Coons and your homies? He said, I know. And I know what we did when I ran with them. So why would I bring them over to my place now and let them rob me crazy? Sometimes the more God lifts you up, the more folk you got to take out of yourself. That some people hinder us from really worshiping, praising God the way we should. has made me glad. Yes. He took my sins. He took my shame. He gave me a name.
He's all that,
y'all.
Yes, he is.
He's all that.
All of that.
put him in a borrowing tomb. Stayed there 3 days and 3 nights. The Bible said it was early Sunday morning that he got up with all power in his hand.
Yes.
Anybody believe he got up?
The doors of the church.